If you are like me and end up prototyping on a breadboard where your components end up being loose and making it very difficult to troubleshoot, take your projects or your prototyping to the next level by going to PCBWay and getting a proper PCB manufactured for your prototyping or your next project. Simply head over to the PCBWay website and click on Instant Quote, and there you can provide the specifications and the requirements for your project and simply place your order. Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this T4D where I'm just going to give some updates about what's been going on in the state of play. An update on the clock project. I'm going to talk about my Leaf and the project I plan to do with that and the driveway. There is a little giveaway as well. So let's kind of jump into it. I just again want to warn folks, if you're either a new subscriber or someone who stumbled across my T4D videos, they're basically, it's a tipple thought for the day. It's a general chit-chat video which may ramble on a bit and may not be that focused. It's a more relaxed chit-chat kind of video. And if that's not your kind of video, then certainly then jump out. I totally respect that. But anyway, so for those of you who are staying here, let's just start off first with the little giveaway. I really do giveaways. At some point in time, I'll do a reason why I don't do competitive giveaways anymore, because I've seen it go wrong in the past. But it just so happens that PCBWay have just had their 6th anniversary. So again, hats off to PCBWay with what they do and the work that they do, and the fact that they're still there as a business, potentially during times like these. It's challenging for everyone, no matter what country you're in. Now, they sent me a swag bag. So there's a t-shirt, there are some PCB rulers, which I'll talk about in a moment. They sent me a pen as well, which I'm gonna keep. And then there's that wonderful flashing LED badge in the background. So first of all, let me just show you the t-shirt. So this is the t-shirt they sent to me. It's actually made out of a nice material. I think it's kind of like a non-crease. I think it's asynthetic, but it feels like quite a nice, comfortable, wearable t-shirt. And then on the back, I know you're all dying to jump up and down to get this t-shirt, right? But I'm going to give first dibs on this t-shirt to Sean in South Africa. So many of you will know Sean. His ID is SeanZA. I think you'll see him in the comments. He's a very good man. He's been around for a long time and assisted me with many things and my forum as well. I'm going to give Sean first dibs. If Sean turns around and says, no, don't worry, give it to someone else, then anyone else who raises their hand, I'll pick at random and I'll send this to you. Sean, even if I think sending things to South Africa is a challenge, so I will send it even if knowing it might go walkabout, because we know what it's like trying to send things to South Africa. But Sean, you have first dibs, and just let me know. If you don't want it, then anyone else who raises their hand will get the PCBWay t-shirt. And again, a big hats off and thanks to PCBWay and Elaine. That's the good lass that I deal with. Now then, the next item, what I'm going to do, I'm going to split these initially to my Patreons and then to any two random folk who raise their hand in the comments below and say, I want the PCBWay ruler, okay? If when I release this video, which always goes first to my Patreons, if no one in the comments of my Patreons during the period that I don't release it to the public, if no one raises a hand and says, hey, yeah, I'd like one of those, and I'll do it kind of either first come first serve, or if there's a few of you interested, I'll pick at random. If they don't go to the patrons, then 4 will go to any of you who are kind of, once I release this to the general public. I think they were 5. I think there was a green one, and I think my daughter managed to grab the green one and took it for herself. So sorry, there's only 4 left. So these rulers, I think you'll find, might be similar to what Dave Jones did. I'm going to give a little close-up. I'll take a photograph and give you a close-up. But I'd say if you are someone who is familiar with a surface mount, footprints and all that kind of thing, maybe leave this for someone who isn't. On the PCB ruler, it's obviously got measurements in both centimeters, millimeters and inches, so you might find that useful. It's got wire gauge holes on here as well to measure wire gauge, but then it specifically shows various surface mount footprints, and it talks about the pitch size and the package. And someone who's not familiar with surface mount footprints and the pitch size and what have you just may find this of interest to have it and have a look at it and get an understanding of that, because you can see all of those laid out on this ruler. So yeah, so those are up for grabs as well. And then I'll decide, I might keep the flashing badge for myself, but if there's another person who raises the hand and says, I really want the flashing badge, there's potential that I'll send that to you as well. Right, so that is the PCBWay bits and pieces. So next, let me talk about the, let me mention when I talk about, because this is something I've become conscious of, is when I say, oh, and the next video is going to be. There's been a couple of cases of this recently, I've just realized, where for one, the power supply project, I said, right, in the next, I did the initial video showing the PCB, and I said, in the next one, I'm going to show you potentially how I would find the PCB, getting a PCB useful for troubleshooting, and then I'd show you its operation, what have you. And then I didn't do that video, and that's because there's a device which I'm going to talk about, which I thought, hang on, this would be really handy to showcase this device which I've got. So often things go awry. I can think that's going to be the next video, and then suddenly something comes in which I have to do either do quicker, or things just get switched around. I had to jump in and do my driveway, which I'm going to talk about. I had to take a week out of filming and production to do that. So then that also mixes things up. And then, for instance, like I said, there was going to be in the next video, I was going to explain about my purchase of the Nissan Leaf rather than the kind of my rant about it, my issues with the dealership and kind of the buying guide. I wanted to go into the details of why I particularly bought this and some of the technical things and why I've got it as a project car. And of course, that gets delayed because I then suddenly I'm working on something else. So I apologize for that, but I say, that's just how it goes sometimes. So let me just explain a little bit about the projects and what I was tied up with the Nissan Leaf. So I purchased this vehicle because I was keen to have an electric car. One of my thoughts was, can I solar charge it? So that's going to be the project. I plan to build a solar powered carport. There's nothing unique about this. You can potentially go out and buy a solar carport, whether you use it to power your home or to directly charge your EV or plug-in hybrid. So, but I plan to do this. I've done the calculations, and it's something I'm going to talk about when I get to that detailed video. But by all accounts, because I've only got an 18-mile commute, the time that I spend here working during the day, the vehicle could be fully charged for my entire commute. So my entire commute to home and back can be charged within less than a day potentially. So that's why I intend to do it. Now the challenge with that was, where do I put the solar powered carport? Because my driveway is 200 feet long. It's got a switchback in the middle where the well is. And if you've watched my videos for a while, you'll kind of, you might have seen some of this in the building of this, my studio, when the truck came up there and all that kind of thing. But the first part of my driveway, which is gravel, rough and rocky, is about 10 to 15% in gradient. We then hit the switchback and it then goes to 20 to 25%. So it is steep, and because it's gravel and washed out gravel, it is difficult to get up. Even in a truck with good clearance, if you've only got a truck with rear-wheel drive, and any front-wheel drive car just seriously struggles. So my Ram 1500 diesel, where I've actually got air suspension, I can lift it up. Got 4x4, it's no problem. I can get up here, and I've kind of enjoyed the fact that my driveway is difficult to get up, because it means that even though there's virtually no one that kind of just willy-nilly drives around here in the mountains, I've certainly had one person, a salesperson, who tried to come up and realized it wasn't going to happen. And I like that. I like it that no odd body is just going to easily drive up my driveway. However, with this project, that is a problem. I kind of wanted to get the Nissan Leaf up here, and I initially thought that basically I'd only be able to get it up halfway to my well, and I'd build the carport down there. Serves two important purposes: for one, charging it, and to keep the car in shade during the day. Again, to do with the battery, if you can keep the ambient temperature around the car cooler, it's better for the longevity of the battery, because it doesn't have cooling. So initially I thought it would be at the well. In order to get it to the well, for one, I have to back the car up the first part of the driveway. Going up forwards with front wheel drive, there's just not enough weight, not enough traction. So I come in and I back up the driveway, there's more weight, and I get enough traction. I had to flatten out one of my water diversions. I had a hump to divert storm water off the property. I had to flatten that out and put in a drain. And once I did that, I was able to get it up into my well. Now, there were two things that happened. For one, when I got there, I thought, I wonder if I can get it up the next section. And the conditions on the day that I tried just happened to be perfect, because if they're not, I wouldn't get it up here. But I think it had rained the day before, and it had dried out a little bit, so the gravel had packed down a little bit, and I've only managed to get it up here once. Otherwise, I just didn't have traction the other times I attempted. But I drove it, and I'll insert a picture here so you can see that I actually got it up. It was a little bit of, you know, turning the wheels to get traction where I could, but I got it up, and I got up, and I thought, wow, if I can get it up here, it makes far more sense to build the carport right up here outside the cabin, because, you know, if I'm here with my truck, if I want to park the truck under the carport, that makes sense. Having the carport right here means that if I want to also use that solar power to power this cabin and try and get it to virtually off grid, it makes far more sense having it here. I've got a direct run to pull the power or the energy straight into the cabin. So of course, then I went through this thinking process of how do I get more traction up this driveway. Now, I know, so the one obvious way is to get it paved, right? The best paving material for this kind of gradient and what have you would be concrete. I know, I've had quotes, to pave this driveway, because it's 200 feet long and because of the gradient, it would cost anywhere from $20,000 to $30,000 to pave this driveway, which I'm not willing to fork out just for the sake of getting the Nissan Leaf up here. But I thought, is there another way? So I took a chance. This was a little experiment, and it seems to be paying off, and I'll explain. So I knew of a product that I looked at quite a few years ago when I was thinking about if someday I wanted to pave this driveway, and it's these GeoGrid. And they go by a number of names. You get them in kind of fixed square panels, which you lock together, is the one option. They've got little cells. And the idea is that if you've got a gravel driveway, you can put these cells together. You kind of need to have a good base when you're using these plastic ones. You have to put down a good base, which is level. And you put them up and you fill them with gravel. You could fill them with concrete. I'll come back to that, but you fill it with gravel, and the idea is then that gives you good traction, and your gravel potentially is going to stay reasonably level. You don't have to really grade it as often, and in place. So when you've got water, that's the biggest problem with a gravel driveway on a bit of a gradient. You've got any water running down, and it doesn't need to be storm water that's not being directed properly, just surface water that collects and then finds a path, washes the gravel out. So this is there to keep the gravel in place. Now, the challenge of that solution can end up being quite expensive, and you need the driveway level. But there's another one. There's these cells which expand. So it's kind of like diamond, I won't call it honeycomb, but you'll see it in the photographs that I'm going to show you. This product, it comes in various thicknesses, 2 inches, 3 inches, and 4 inches, and you just expand it and pin it out, and then you can fill that with gravel or concrete. My initial idea actually wasn't to either do the gravel or the concrete, it was actually to fill just the wheel tracks that the Leaf would have needed, to fill the wheel tracks with cold patch asphalt. Put the cold patch asphalt in there because I thought it's less risk if I can't get the thickness because of the steepness of the driveway. It's not going to crack up. So I'll fill that up, and then I'll fill the other bits up to keep it down, give it mass, with concrete. Get bags of concrete and wet it. But as it turned out, the cost of doing that, once you account for the bags of asphalt and what have you, creeps up there to the point where it is actually beyond getting someone with a pump and merely paying for a truckload of concrete. So that's what I did. Now, I had my doubts as to whether this was going to work, because I initially purchased the product, which is only 2 inches thick. That's not very thick. My concern was it wasn't going to be thick enough. You wouldn't be able to get any thicker concrete on there. My dad, who's a retired civil engineer, also pointed out that generally speaking, if you're going to pump concrete, it might be a bit more liquidy, and there's a good risk that the concrete would just run underneath this and back down the hill. So it was a risk, but these expandable pieces were literally $99, so $100 each. So I thought, well, let me do a small section of the driveway and test it as an experiment, because if it works, it could work out a lot cheaper than paying for a normal driveway. So I spoke to the contractor who helped me build the studio, who's a very good friend now, and he said, well, yeah, you could get awesome. What we'll do, because he actually helped me find a guy to pump the concrete and what have you, and he said you can get concrete which is normally poured for a normal floor slab or for footings or a foundation, and that tends to be a bit thicker. So we'll get the thicker concrete, and you can get the concrete which has got the fibers in it. So it acts as a bit of a structural reinforcement to help prevent cracking and that kind of thing, particularly as you're not going to put a rebar or anything like that into the structure. Now, potentially you could, but then again, it gets expensive. As soon as you have someone setting up forms or rebar, the cost to shoot up. Here in the States, it's not the materials, it's the labor. So I spent 2 days pinning this lattice work out down the driveway. It did involve, literally, the base is good because I've got bedrock underneath for the most part. So I fortunately got a very good Makita rotary drill. I was able to drill in to secure the pegs, which help open it up. There are some stringers which go through, which help it support it down, and you can use those to peg it out as well. So just over 8 feet wide, each section is about 30 feet long. So I've got about just over 90 feet on this first run. The ground underneath isn't exactly level, but the good contractor said, you know what, the concrete will just go in there and fill that up. So the day of the pour, I only ordered about 7 yards of concrete. I thought we calculated for 2 inches thick, having a little bit extra just in case. But as they started pouring it, of course, the guys who came to pour it kind of looked and went, okay, this is a interesting new solution. They always kind of form up. They've never seen this product before, but they started pouring it, and the concrete, for one, stayed in place. It didn't roll down the hill, and they were surprised. They said, you know what, even when we set up forms on a slope this steep, the concrete will generally start to roll down. We have to kind of pour more and pull it up until it starts to settle a little bit. But this lattice work just held it in place, and in fact, they were able to pour the concrete anywhere from 1 inch to 2 inches. For the most part, the concrete is sitting at 3.5 to 4 inches thick, and that is the thickness that they would normally pour a driveway. So it's gone well beyond what I thought would be possible in terms of 2 inches. It's gone to 3.5, 4 inches, and it's been only a week. So I've been spraying it with water to help it slow down the cure rate, so it sets up as strong as possible. But it looks like it's going to work. And so my plan is to do the rest of the driveway. I'm having to sell some test equipment to be able to pay for the rest of it, because it's still not cheap, but it'll cost me probably less than half of the quotes to actually do the driveway. And that means I can get the Nissan Leaf up here. I'm going to build the solar carport. I've been investigating solar panels. I haven't looked at the pricing of solar panels, and I'm just amazed how they've dropped. I mean, when I first started playing with solar panels, they cost $10 to $12 per watt. The last time I looked, you could buy solar panels, reasonable solar panels, for about $1 per watt. And now it's down to like less than 50 US cents per watt, which is incredible. And if you buy the larger solar panels, the cost per watt potentially is cheaper. Obviously, there's less material than buying a smaller solar panel in terms of the framing and the glass. So that's going to be an interesting exercise. Is I'll take you along with the process of choosing the solar panels and the setup. And then what do I do for the energy storage? There's lots of interesting thoughts flying through my mind, moving away from a traditional AGM battery. How about a lithium battery or LTO cells? Maybe you have a hybrid where you have LTO cells which can grab as much energy quickly when it's there, because your problem with the traditional charging is you can only charge at a certain rate and then it starts slowing down. Whereas if you're using something which is almost like a capacitor, when the sun's out, you just grab all that energy, and then potentially you could use that to charge a larger capacity, because those might, the kind of the energy density is not the best. You could charge those up quickly and then use those to charge a cheaper, larger capacity technology. So there's a whole lot of ideas flowing through my head. So potentially an interesting solar project there. Right, so enough of the driveway and the car. Let me just quickly tell you about the device that I've actually won in an auction. Now, I point out that I won this in an auction. The device I'm talking about is a variable isolated AC power source. Now, you're probably going to find, generally speaking, we don't have them on our benches. For one, there are not many of them around. And if you try and buy one that is currently being produced, you're going to pay upwards of $1,500 to $10,000. They are very expensive devices. So they're particularly useful if you want to test a power supply. So what I obviously did when I first got this to test it, I didn't get a transformer and hook it into mains and switch it on and hope for the best, because the risk is if there's a short or there's something awry, it could just go bang. So obviously I get my DC power supply, I connect up onto the rails where I know the DC is, and I slowly crank up. I can limit the current and make sure that there's nothing awry while I'm testing it. But what if you've got a device, an appliance, or you want to move to the next point where I actually want to add AC power into this? So I could simulate the secondary side of a transformer, which might be sitting at 20 odd volts or 30 odd volts RMS going into there. If I could have a variable AC supply where I can control the current, because I could get a variac, right? I can have a variac and I can turn that down to a low AC voltage, but there's nothing limiting the current. Also, a variac isn't isolated, so potentially there's a safety issue there, as you'll have seen in some of my previous videos. So getting a device which allows you to have variable AC supply and to control or have a trip to limit the current is a challenge. So I found one on eBay. I because they discontinued and very hard to get hold of, I had to participate in an auction. And there might be an interesting video there is to explain how I go about trying to win something on eBay through an auction. I don't like doing auctions. But sometimes you're forced to. There's a piece of equipment and it's just discontinued and not available. I did a whole lot of research. I phoned across the country, in fact, to see if I could try find another one of these devices for a reasonable price without going into the auction, and I couldn't. But I've got a certain method of going into an auction, which is different from other people's methods. But anyway, if you're interested in that, I can do a video on that. I've got this device, it'll come in the near future. We'll hook it up and test the power supply. But I also think there's a way that most folks might be able to have a safe variable AC supply on their bench with a few off-the-shelf components. So I've got a few components coming, and I'm going to try and put together a poor man's AC isolated AC power supply where you can have control or limit the current. So that'll be coming up. Right, let's get to the bench and I'll show you the state of play with my clock project, where we can talk about the performance of a temperature compensated crystal oscillator, an ovenized one versus a rubidium one, and the costs. And I'll tell you what I'm going to choose and why. And just to say, it's going to start winding up soon because I think I've got everything together where I can put it in a box and I'll have my high accuracy clock complete. Right then, a little bit of freehand before we look at some facts and figures. As you'll know from a previous video, I plan to drive this analog clock. I have that working. I've made some coding updates to the Arduino code which runs the clock. As I say, that's still a work in progress, but this is still working. I have had this working off this frequency standard, which you saw me do the fix for. I say I won't call it a repair because I didn't actually suss out what the cause of the problem was, but I saw where the problem was and I did the fix to get this working. This frequency standard has got a 192K output, and I have set the clock on my Arduino project to run to that so that this works as a source and I can insert the atomic clock or the rubidium standard into there. And I've had it running like that as a quick test, but I've still got a bit of testing to do. So let me show you the other bit of interest. So up here you'll recognize, if you watched the previous videos, is the Datum rubidium standard that I purchased. So you'll see this is the entire standard with the required heatsink. So it is large, and what happened, I had this on test and I have it plugged into this little backup supply so that if the power goes out, it doesn't stop running and the clock stops. And I was rushing out one evening, I put it on here and I forgot to put this in and the battery ran out. And I don't know whether it ran out and perhaps went on and off, but when I came back the next day, I just plugged it in thinking it'd be fine. And after an hour or two, this started losing lock. So the frequency went off and it drifted. It'd come back at locking to 10 megahertz. So something has gone awry with this. And this is a good lesson. This is something I warned about, is the lifespan of these rubidium standards. And you can go back and watch that video if you kind of want more information on that. So potentially we've got a little project on our hands here is to open this up and see if we can understand what has happened or if it is repairable. I particularly bought this one because it is bigger and potentially the parts inside are serviceable, and a lot of people have written little manuals on this in terms of how they work. So there is the potential. But what I purchased is this one off eBay, is the AccuBeat. So the AccuBeat is made by an Israeli company, the footprint, and this is why I bought it, because for this project it is a really tiny footprint. They also claim, as long as the ambient temperature is kept reasonable, 1.4 million hours before failure. They claim it's built to be used in harsh environments, so it's fairly robust. So I'm hoping that this will provide far better longevity if I use it as a, well, not if I, I will use it as a clock source for the atomic version of the clock. However, okay, so there's something interesting to note. For one, there's a lot less heat coming off this. I've got this fan going at very slow speed. Without the fan, the temperature on here sits at around 40 degrees Celsius around 42 degrees Celsius. With a fan, this drops to like 32 degrees Celsius. So there's very little heat dissipation. In its normal mode of operation, I think it's only drawing about 9 watts. So a really nice candidate for this project. I'll just show you here on the frequency counter. So that is where the frequency is sitting at the moment. And what I want you to note is that on that input, I've got the 10 times attenuator switched on. Now, so here's the interesting fact. I'll just unplug this and I'll show you something. So I'll just plug this in, I'll show you. And from the spec sheet, if you see what this should be at, the sine wave output from this should be at 2.5 volts peak to peak. That is with 50 ohm impedance. So obviously the impedance setting is important. So I've got this set to 50 ohm. And if you have a look at the amplitude of it, 20 volts. So I did get this for a cheaper price. I offered a lower price for it and I got it at a cheaper price. And I say cheaper, these were going for $400. I got this one for $300. So these still aren't cheap. If it lasts and it is robust, it'll certainly be worth it, but I'm going to have to attenuate that signal because 20 volts peak to peak is not going to be good for the frequency standard. So I've got a little bit of homework to do there to attenuate that signal. Shouldn't be too hard, but I wonder if this is why it was retired. It seems like an odd fault. I'm not sure whether something has failed inside, which has changed the impedance and changed the output voltage, but it's something I should be able to address with an external impedance on it. So, yep, that's the one little challenge there. Right. So the one thing I wanted to show you, I've still got the long-term project, and I know, sorry, the lights are reflecting in here. This is the long-term project. You'll get a better picture. I've got another one on the bench, but basically what I want to show you through the reflections there is the number of days. So it is coming up for 160 days that it's been running. So this one's been running for 160 days. So it is up by 184 milliseconds after 159, call it 160 days. So we'll look at that calculation. And then here is the other clock that I'm running. So that is, it's not running off the Leo Bodnar GPS disciplined oscillator. It is running off this adjustable ovenized crystal oscillator. Now this one puts out a square wave. Now the handy thing about this one is you can configure what you want it to run at. So at the back here, you'll see there's a display and I've got the one output set at 100 kilohertz, which is what I'm running this clock at, and then I've got a 10 megahertz. So you can configure two of the outputs and the other one is fixed at 10 megahertz. We're going to talk about the cost of these because obviously that is part of the picture if you want to build yourself a high accuracy clock. But that is what this is running off. As you can see, it's just on 10 days. I'll switch that across. And that is running at, if we look at that, 418, almost 419 microseconds. Now we'll look at the calculations. I did the calculations yesterday and they've changed very slightly, but we'll do a comparison between the three to see over a year, potentially how things are going to look. Right, so having a look at some of these figures, and these have changed from the last time that I showed you these figures because there's been some drift, for instance, like in the temperature compensated crystal oscillator in the Leo Bodnar device. Now the Leo Bodnar device, I just want to highlight, isn't designed to run in either holdover or free running mode where it doesn't have a GPS signal. It's designed to run accurately with a GPS signal, but when you lose a GPS signal, it's got algorithms to maintain a good output, which you can program. You can either have it at 10 megahertz or you've got a whole wide range that you can set it to, which is the benefit of that device. Also a small package powered with USB 5 volt. So really nice, neat, small package if you want to use it as a time base for a clock. But on average, it has drifted about 1.1 milliseconds per day. Now, I can tell you that's an average over the time period, but right at the moment, it is sitting at probably 1.2 to 1.3 milliseconds per day. So it is still drifting, and of course, as that drift increases, it greatly affects the accumulated drift over a year. But currently, as it stands, that device would be around 418 milliseconds per year. It could drift out a bit more. As I say, I'm going to keep it running for at least a year to see how well it does. But it'll still be sub 3 second, which was my initial goal. It should be sub 1 second, I would hope. And that little package costs about $140 as a time base. Then we get to the ovenized crystal oscillator, the one I'm currently running. You saw the stats, even since yesterday when I wrote this down. It's obviously crept slightly, but it is at roughly currently 41 microseconds per day, which is really good. I'll give you a bit of background to this, though. I had it when I initially switched it on. I saw the frequency drift a fair bit within the first few days, and it settled down after about 4 or 5 days. So the drift has slowed down, and that's part of the aging process. Ideally, you kind of want to run it for a month or so so that it ages and it becomes more stable, and it should become more stable over time. But at its current rate, that would put it within roughly 15 milliseconds per year that it would maintain. Now, I'm fairly sure it's going to drift out of that. I think the specifications on an ovenized crystal oscillator, you're probably looking at 1 to 300 milliseconds per year, but that's still about a third of a second, roughly. So that would, for the longevity and robustness of an ovenized crystal oscillator, this looks like a tempting option, particularly when you look at, let's say, its price point. And again, these are off-the-shelf items. The whole idea was to be able to pull items easily that are contained. You don't need any major electronics experience. If someone with very little electronics know-how wants to put this together, you could do it. It obviously costs more. You could do this a lot less if you just get the plain oscillator and you've got your own circuit. You could build it for a lot less. But the rubidium standards, you're looking at anywhere, let's say, from $250 to $500 potentially. You are going to get really nice stability over the long run. My previous one was doing around 6 point something microseconds per day. That would mean 2.4 milliseconds per year. Now, if you stayed within that, you're looking at hundreds of years that you're going to be within 1 second accuracy. However, the longevity of these devices is obviously questionable. Some of these devices that you buy may only last 2-5 years because of the lamp inside there. And I did explain this in a previous video. So in my mind, the best time base for this project to give you reasonably good accuracy and robustness for the price would be an ovenized crystal oscillator. Off the shelf, certainly the Lear Bodnar device for the accuracy and the flexibility of the device is certainly an option as well. Now, bear in mind, the code that I've written for the Arduino does have, I can build in a correction factor. So once I've been running one of these for, let's say, a week, a month, I can then see how much it's drifting per day, and I can actually digitally trim or compensate for that. So I can actually bring these figures down a fair bit, but without that, this is what they tend towards. So certainly I would say for this project, this would be the best solution, an ovenized crystal oscillator. I am going to build one with the rubidium standard just for the fun of, because I want an atomic clock. But yeah, for the most folks, I say that's probably the best option. Right then, so I hope you found that of interest. There are, I say, quite a few interesting things on the boil. I am particularly interested to see if I can pull off this tool which I've always wanted, although I've got one which I know hopefully will work from eBay, having an isolated variable AC supply on the bench for a reasonable cost. I'm really intrigued to see if I can pull that off. I'll just mention one other thing I forgot. I know people have said they're hoping to see more solar powered stuff, and of course with the project for the Nissan Leaf, that's going to happen. Potentially trying to get my cabin off grid as well in terms of power, because once I've got power off grid with power, I'm basically off grid with everything besides internet. There's a good gent I've mentioned before who's working on building a solar charger, and he sent me some solar panels to test, or solar cells. So he sent me these on both monocrystalline. This is a SunPower one versus a traditional monocrystalline cell. He sent me 10 of each. These come from a Chinese company which he's got to encapsulate his cells of choice. I'm going to test them because I tested a previous panel that he is working on. But because he's provided me with 10 of each, this will allow me to do an interesting demonstration I've been hoping to do for a while in terms of the way you can connect solar panels together to harvest energy with low light, because this is what I'm dealing with my solar powered coffee table. So hopefully now that I've got these, I can also put that together. But anyway, at the end of this video, if you've made it this far, just after the credits, I'll show you, I've done this before, you know, I have a little visitor who sometimes comes around my cabin, and he's started making his appearance because the blueberries are about to come out. Some of the other fruits like raspberries and blackberries, wild, which grow wild around you, are out, but the blueberries aren't. And I know the visitor loves the blueberries, but he decided to come out yesterday afternoon, and he thought he'd take a closer look. Maybe he's trying to fix a connection on one of my solar panels. But anyway, thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you for the next video soon. Cheers.